Let's begin with prayer this morning. Our Father, we want to begin by committing our time to you, as we do week by week, so that we may be under your guidance, that we may have the teaching presence of the Holy Spirit, that we may be under the lordship of Christ and recognize that he reigns and rules over us, that we are his kingdom, his people in the world, and that the world is a dangerous place to be a Christian. And so we pray that by looking into your word, we might learn what we need for wisdom, to be alert in the world, but also to remain in a sincere love for the brethren and a commitment to the cause of God's kingdom. We pray this through Christ. Amen. All right, we're into the second part of the introduction of Evangelicalism's 10 Harmful Tendencies. And I left off with a description of the evangelical church in America as sort of the religious version of the melting pot, where all kinds of different traditions, whether they be strictly religious, more specifically Protestant, even Catholic to a degree, find their way into this melting pot and have created, in the context of American culture, an almost new form of Christianity. And we looked at the four traits of evangelicalism: conversionism, that is the necessity of a born-again experience; activism, the need to be engaged with the world in one way or another, whether it's in missions or in social transformation; biblicism, a belief that the Bible is God's inspired, inerrant word; and crucicentrism, that the death of Christ on the cross is for the salvation of sinners. To varying degrees, all of that's true. My point is, in reviewing that, is this is a pretty low bar for entering into something that is distinctively Christian. In other words, if this is the common denominator, not even necessarily, I suppose, on the face of it anyway, the historic creeds, but just these four pillars, well, that's either a very low bar for entry, or, using the more typical image, a very large and wide tent that will house many people. And in order to preserve that, it's quite possible, indeed it's probably likely, that the details of orthodoxy, that is, of what Christians have believed traditionally, that are represented in different traditions, will inevitably be minimized or overlooked, and trouble will follow. So anyone, or close to anyone, can step over that bar, and it doesn't allow the church to guard all the entranceways into the big tent. So the term evangelical can apply to such a wide range of, say, Christian teachers who in one way or another could sign off on those four points, that it's absolutely amazing that they could all find themselves housed in the one great tent. And as I think I pointed out last week, the more people become evangelical, the less they identify with their own Christian traditions, so they end up losing the value those traditions have provided to the church, the protective traditions. One of the marks of evangelicalism, it's not the one of the ten tendencies, is sort of an arrogance of the modern. If it's new, it's better. And the old ways of doing things are automatically under suspicion. I don't follow the evangelical world as closely as I used to, but when I first came out here 20 plus years ago, I was a little bit more observant in the local scene, and everything then was church growth. That still might be the case, I'm just not an observer any longer. And often in the promotional literature, come to my church, the postcards that would come in the mail, the ads that would be taken out in the Kansas City Star, would be, this is not your grandmother's church. No long sermons. In other words, we're not like traditional Christians. We're something new and fresh and accessible to ordinary people. I thought, what a strange thing to leverage the Christian tradition as a way to get people to come to your church by saying, look, we don't follow that any longer. No one just gets up there, reads the Bible, and preaches to you. It's interesting to me. But the four pillars allow for that. There is no sense of tradition or a connection to the tradition and the protection that that tradition provides. So churches become functionally creedless, even if they would say otherwise. They are functionally creedless. So as important as conversionism, activism, though I'm going to put an asterisk next to activism, biblicism and crucicentrism are, they aren't enough to guard and supervise and protect and preserve a church that is under attack. And under attack is something I'm going to define in just a moment. Now, let me put in a caveat here. It's the nature of a class like this that I am painting evangelicalism with a very broad brush. I'm stating that up front, just like I'm stating up front that I'm not interested in a mean-spirited attack against people who are our brothers and sisters. So, what I say about evangelicalism in general may actually not apply to certain subcategories within evangelicalism. This is not an academic paper. It may sound to other people like an academic paper, but I'm not doing research so that I'm providing footnotes and citations of where I've done my studies and who has taken polls and all the rest. This is more of an editorial approach. You know, in op-eds, when they write in the paper, they tend to write in more broad strokes without feeling the need to provide ample empirical evidence to base on every criticism that they have of this or that policy or politician. So yes, I am painting evangelicalism with a broad brush, and I will try and make distinctions as we go. So there are subcategories within evangelicalism that are more susceptible to certain kinds of errors or harmful tendencies than other subcategories. Because remember, evangelicalism covers everything from the charismatic Pentecostal movement all the way over to what we associate with fundamentalism. Though the term fundamentalism in the modern world isn't what it used to mean, fundamentalism being kind of that rigid, almost legalistic approach to the Christian faith that is characterized by rules and regulations. All of these fit under the evangelical tent. So I'm saying that up front so nobody needs to get nervous that I'm being too general. So just because there is a harmful tendency in one group, how many of you know who Kenny Copeland is? He might have been more famous 10 or 20 years ago, or Kenneth Hagin. As far as I can tell, technically, these men qualify as being evangelicals. If you go by the four pillars, I'm not sure I can, maybe if I started looking carefully into their doctrine of the atonement, we might find something that's troubling. But generally speaking, they would look for conversion. They are insistent that the Bible is God's word, strongly so. They believe that Christ died for sinners, and they see their mission as promoting this gospel of prosperity for those who belong to Christ. Well, a lot of us, I think rightly, are uncomfortable with the prosperity gospel. But it's evangelical in this very broad, loose, easily stretched sense. Okay, a little bit of personal history here and why I think this class is important. This isn't just an attempt to caricature people that aren't reformed or point fingers at the bad guys who are, you know, shallow. And it came from this. There's a New Testament context. When I was studying 2 Peter and Jude in seminary, I spent a whole semester working on what amounts to four chapters of the New Testament, three in 2 Peter and one in Jude. And there was one message in those two epistles that was so clear, that was so obvious, that unless you had some prejudice against the biblical text, you couldn't miss it. And the message was that the greatest threats to the Christian churches did not originate on the outside of the Christian churches. The greatest threats to the Christian churches did not originate on the outside, that is, from the larger pagan world, from the empire, from the synagogues. We think of the early church as people who were persecuted by the authorities for their faith. And there's some truth in that. But in these epistles, the greatest threats to the Christian churches originated on the inside, from within, that is, from divisive people, and most dangerous of all, from false Christian teachers of all sorts. So while Christians in America, I think generally speaking, are always looking outside the window of the church and trying to forecast persecution, and now there's gay marriage, and there's a woman in Kentucky who was put in jail because she wouldn't sign certificate. We're looking outside the window, trying to see what's coming on the horizon, because that's where we think the threat originates. But when you read the epistles, the main and most dangerous threat originates on the inside. And most dangerously of all, from false Christian teachers of all sorts. 2 Peter 2, 1 through 3. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. We have the history of Israel. We have a history of their false prophets and how destructive they were to the kingdom. Peter says, just as there were false prophets that arose among the Israelites, there will be false teachers among you. There will be who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. They're not going to show up at the church door and say, "Good morning, I have a heresy. Are you interested in buying?" They are going to do this secretly, and many will follow their sensuality. Many will follow. And because of them, the way of truth will be blasphemed. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. So Peter is tapping into the history of redemption, as the apostles always do. And even a cursory Sunday school reading of the Old Testament makes this point over and over again. False prophets lead God's people into idolatry and into judgment. And what Peter is saying to the New Testament church is, nothing has changed. What was true then is true now. Now, obviously, a lot has changed in terms of the work of Christ, his death, resurrection, ascension, the gift of the Spirit. But in terms of the earthly life of the people of God, false teachers will come to you. But he's not content to leave it there. And as I read this, you know, it's interesting how much attention this soon-to-be-executed apostle devotes to this subject in just a 3-chapter letter. This is from chapter 2, beginning in verse 9. God is able to keep the unrighteous under punishment until the day of judgment, and especially those who indulge in the lust of defiling passion and despise authority. Bold and willful, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones, whereas angels, though greater in might and power, do not pronounce a blasphemous judgment against them before the Lord. But these, like irrational animals, creatures of instinct, born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction, suffering wrong as the wage for their wrongdoing. They count it pleasure to revel in the daytime. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions while they feast with you. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady souls. They have hearts trained in greed, accursed children. Forsaking the right way, they have gone astray. They have followed the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved gain from wrongdoing, but was rebuked for his own transgression. A speechless donkey spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These are waterless springs and mists driven by a storm. For them the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved. For speaking loud boasts of folly, they entice by sensual passions of the flesh those who are barely escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For whatever overcomes a person, to that he is enslaved. So here's this huge chunk of chapter 2, again, dedicated to the people who are in the church, not on the church's property, trying to get in. But he's not done yet. Chapter 3, 1 through 6. This is now the second letter that I am writing to you, beloved. In both of them, I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder, that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles, knowing this first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. They will say, "Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation." For they deliberately overlook this fact, that the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and through water, by the word of God, and that by means of these the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished. And there's more. I'm reading all of this to make a mark. How much time and attention? I'm reminding you again, says Peter. I have to write a second letter because you have a hard time remembering what I told you the last time I wrote. Chapter 3, 13 through 18. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. And count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him, as he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters. There are some things in them that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do other scriptures. Now, this is a line you could easily pass over, but it at least suggests that the scriptures themselves will be unstably twisted within the church. So, you know, Peter is not saying what I'm about to say, but simply saying that the Bible is God's inspired and authoritative word is not sufficient to guard against scripture twisting. And remember, the whole ethos of this is that God's people who are vulnerable, who are almost certain to be attacked, are in other ways passive and trusting and non-critical of what they experience as Christians. Nothing in here about Roman soldiers coming to arrest you because you're observing the Lord's Supper. All of this is what happens within. You there, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. And we haven't even gotten to Jude yet. So here is an edited version of Jude. Beloved, although I was very eager to write about our common salvation, this is verse 3, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. I wanted to write a happy letter about what we enjoy together as God's people, but I find myself put in the spot of having to remind you again that the faith is vulnerable, it must be guarded, protected, and contended for. Against the atheists, against Richard Dawkins, against Christopher Hitchens, for certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. They've crept in. They're in your churches. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. Dropping now to verse 11. Woe to them, for they walked in the way of Cain and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's errors and perished in Korah's rebellion. Remember, Cain, Balaam, and Korah are all in one way or another connected to the covenant community. Balaam is an outsider, but he is prophesying to and about Israel. These are hidden reefs at your love feast, as they feast with you without fear, shepherds feeding themselves. Shepherds. Waterless clouds swept along by winds, fruitless trees in late autumn, twice dead, uprooted, wild waves of the sea casting up the foam of their own shame, wandering stars for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. Drop down to verse 16. These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loudmouth boasters, showing favoritism to gain advantage. But you must remember, beloved, the predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. They said to you, in the last time there will be scoffers following their own ungodly passions. See what this common theme of, I am reminding you again, remember what the apostles told you. Why are you acting as if you are safe and sound within the boundaries of the church? And if you realize that the last days began at Pentecost, you know that Peter's not talking about some future 7-year period before the return of Jesus. He's talking about now. It is these who cause divisions, worldly people devoid of the Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. Now, this is just 2 Peter and Jude. And I read large chunks to show you how much pen and ink within 4 chapters of 2 epistles is devoted to the theme of you guys are in constant danger. Not from forces that are pressing on you from without, but from corrupting forces that secretly are working their way in from outside. John was concerned with the same thing. Read 1 John chapter 4. And the same goes for the dominant post-resurrection figure in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul. Ephesians 4, 11 through 16. The whole book of Galatians. His farewell message in Acts chapter 20, 28 through, 28 and following. And 1 Timothy 6, 3 through 5, just to quote one. If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and deprived of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. So even though all of these New Testament writers wrote what they wrote for different reasons, and they were forced to address various needs and crises and errors and sins in all the New Testament churches, yet they all share this one common concern, that their churches have been targeted for attack, that they are all in one way or another under attack all the time. This is the spiritual warfare that Paul speaks about, which is manifested materially and corporally in the church by false teachers. So when evangelicals look around today and see trouble ahead, same-sex marriage, federal mandates, persecution is coming. I've had those conversations already with people. My point is, you're being persecuted right now. You've been persecuted in the 18th century, the 17th century, the 16th century, and on and on and on, back to when Christ poured out his Spirit on his people on the day of Pentecost. Don't look outside the window at the fence to see the trouble. The trouble is always here in your midst, or at least the threat of it is. So persecution is not so much from pagan neighbors or the governing authorities, though that's obviously true. But if we make a mental association, persecution equals hostility from the authorities, we will overlook what's right in front of us. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. 1 John 4:1. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, Paul admonished the Ephesian elders, to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. Listen to this again. Paul's talking to elders from the Ephesian church, to elders. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves, men will arise speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. So if you're staring out the church window, scanning the horizon for danger while your friend bolts the door, you're not paying attention to the apostles. The guy who just bolted the door may be the biggest problem you have. Now, this is not to make everybody paranoid, so that you all kind of start looking at each other and wondering, is Gene the one? It's the quiet ones, right, who end up, and before you know it, we're all... That's certainly not the point. But it's way out of balance. Because the warfare is spiritual. You say, well, it doesn't make sense for someone to come into a local church and cause trouble. And I would say it makes perfect sense. As long as we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers and principalities and the powers of the air. It makes perfect sense. And the apostles spend an enormous amount of time trying to prepare the church, remind the church that this is their main source of trouble. So our four-point definition of evangelicalism brings out an irony. Evangelical biblicism is its high regard for obedience to the Bible as its ultimate authority. And as we'll see when we get to that section, that's fine, but you have to do what it says. You have to pay attention to all the bits, not just the ones that you like the best or that define who you are or have become popular so that you win a Twitter following or a host of other things. All of it. So, what is at stake? What is at stake? Well, I believe from the depths of my heart that Christians are facing the greatest threat that this country has ever witnessed. And if we don't take action now, Christianity in America may wither and die. I'm just kidding. I have no idea what's going to happen in the future. I have no idea what's going to happen in the future. But I cannot count the times. I call that evangelical hype. You have to turn the temperature way, way up to get people to move, to act, and probably to give. But nobody knows the future. And those types of statements are ultimately irresponsible and misleading. They don't have anything to do with the kingdom of God. Now, some of you may know that the title of this series Evangelicalism's 10 harmful tendencies is satirical in itself. I'm poking fun, I hope harmless fun, but maybe with a little edge to it, at the evangelical tendency to reduce the Christian faith to a manageable number of steps. I went to the CBD catalog, Christian book distributors, and I typed in steps. Here are some books. Pages and pages of books showed up. Discipleship, 5 steps that help your church to make disciples who make disciples. The Source of Miracles, 7 steps to transforming your life through the Lord's Prayer. 10 basic steps toward Christian maturity, the Leader's Guide. That's for a series. The 5 levels of leadership, proven steps to maximize your potential. Married but Lonely, 7 steps you can take with or without your spouse's help. And Your Best Life Now, 7 steps to living at your full potential. That one is Joel Osteen. So it's a little tongue-in-cheek to narrow it down to 10, because it's like 3, 5, 7, and 10. I don't know if anyone does 17 steps. That would be completely unmanageable. 10 is probably the highest you can go. Maybe 12. 12 steps. Yeah, okay. So I've narrowed my list down to 10 harmful tendencies. These are the things that can take root and grow up healthy within evangelicalism, because that 4-point soil, Biblicism, Christocentrism, activism, and conversionism, is fertile for these types of plants. But you ask, who are you to take this upon yourself? Well, I'm going to now offer you my credentials. This is my curriculum vitae. I am 56 years old now. I've been a Christian, at least as far as I know, since about the age of 21. So I've had a lot of time, and I have a lot of experience under my belt. So here's my CV. Many of you have heard of my former conduct as an evangelical, how I opposed Calvinism, how I opposed non-charismatics and dismissed dead churches, and how I tried to refute them. Indeed, I was advancing in evangelicalism beyond most of my peers. So if anyone else thinks he may have confidence as an evangelical, I more so. I was a member of not one, but 2 parachurch missionary groups. I was baptized by a team leader off of Key West on a mission trip. As a dispensationalist, I lived in Israel. As to my discipling, the Navigators with their scripture memory program. As a Pentecostal, I attended an Assemblies of God Bible College and graduated summa cum laude. I even graduated with the highest honors from a prominent evangelical seminary. I used to read and even subscribe to Christianity Today. I taught in a Christian high school for 6 years, and I pastored a church for evangelical refugees in Kansas. So I am well acquainted with popular evangelicalism. I actively participated in it in the past, and remain to varying degrees an ongoing observer of it. I think I can speak fairly and wisely about it. And as I noted earlier, if Stackhouse's definition is correct, then I am an evangelical. It is a low bar, but I meet the qualifications. I heartily believe what my denomination has historically taught about Christian doctrine, but I believe those 4 pillars. This explains why I am not attacking evangelicalism in this series. I am a part of the very broad evangelical family. So I think of this series as what N.T. Wright called criticism from within. Criticism from within. It's a term that he used to refer to the confrontations that occur within communities where the objective is the purity and faithfulness of those communities, whether it be the Pharisees or Israel's prophets. And here's the point. The critic, me, is himself a loyal member of his community. I'm motivated by love for, and religiously, a love for the church and for the God who rules it. Martin Luther, of course, may be the most well-known historical example of this criticism from within. He expressed it first when he posted his 95 Theses because he wanted to promote healthy intra-church debate. That was, Luther did not post his theses on the Wittenberg door to say, I'm leaving the Roman Catholic Church. Far from it. He posted the theses so that the leaders in the church, the educated in the church, would be able to have a conversation about the church's health and well-being. Luther left the Roman Church when he was excommunicated by the Pope, not at his own initiative. And I truly believe that if enough Christian men and women would take this teaching to heart and spread it around, we will see revival in this country than we haven't seen since the 18th century. No, I'm kidding. I have no idea what will happen. But I do want to be faithful with the message. That's as far as my responsibilities go. So let me go over briefly the 10 harmful tendencies. They are not listed in any particular order, except for numbers 1 and 10, both of which get to root causes, as I see it, of the harmful tendencies. 1, evangelicalism tends to rely on multiple authorities and not the Bible alone. You could put in parentheses, after Bible alone, the inspired and errant word of God. We've already established that that is one of the pillars. Nevertheless, evangelicalism tends to rely on multiple authorities and not the Bible alone. Evangelicalism tends to stress moral reform over redemption. Evangelicalism tends to seek and promote experiences over truth. Evangelicalism tends to confuse church and state. 5, evangelicalism tends to be pragmatic. That's a homegrown, all-American philosophy, so that in its pragmatism, it aims for quantity over quality. Evangelicalism tends to elevate personalities over the Church of God. 7, evangelicalism tends to embrace an incomplete and misdirected eschatology. That will take some unpacking, of course. Evangelicalism tends to exalt individualism over the community. That's a crucial one. This is one place where modern Christianity as a whole, at least in the West, is almost openly at odds with the New Testament epistles. Evangelicalism tends to exalt individualism over the community. Evangelicalism tends to react to the culture rather than create a counterculture. And finally, evangelicalism tends to be semi-Pelagian and not Augustinian. That is the end of the introduction, and really it brings us to the end of the Sunday school hour. Next week I'm going to hand out my various rules, guidelines, and logical fallacies, revised and updated. Because I find over and over again that any intra-church conversations are bogged down because these same rules are broken, guidelines are ignored, and logical fallacies are employed in intra-church conversation. I face them over and over again. So if I hand this sheet out, I can say, instead of saying, no, it's not really like that, I'll just say Rule 42. Just look it up. And it'll be right there, and maybe that will help us move the discussion further along. I'll take a question or two or three.
So as you started this, you talked about the low bar set by evangelicalism and complained that as a result of that, evangelicals no longer have the protection of the historic Protestant traditions. As I think historically, say to the early to mid 20th century, evangelicals would have said, well, we're defending these very few things because these are under attack, but we have this modernist error and we must, we have people saying, denying virgin birth, denying atoning sacrifice, denying all these very basic things, and that's where we have to coalesce and defend that, even at the expense of defending our distinctives within Protestantism. And by the way, where did this error come from? It came precisely from all of the historic churches, and in fact, where is the protective value that you speak of? Didn't the modernist error arise within Presbyterian and Lutheran and Methodist churches? So how can you say that these traditions have protective value when that's exactly where the biggest threat to the church has come from?
Oh, right. I said protective value. I didn't say makes them invulnerable. In other words, I'm going to do better in a gunfight if I have a bulletproof vest on than if I don't. But if my opponent shoots me in the knee or the thigh or in the head, my bulletproof vest isn't going to do me any good. Nevertheless, I'd rather be wearing the vest than not wearing the vest when I'm in the gunfight. So the apostles, and that's why I wanted to root this in the New Testament, they have no illusions about how troubled the church will be. That's why they keep focusing on, I'm reminding you again, go back to first things. By the time the fundamentalist modernist controversy got underway in full, and this isn't a history class, so I'm not trying to get all the details right, the damage had already been done. In other words, people were not alert. They were trusting, they were indulgent, and before they knew it, they had an enormous crisis on their hands, to which they responded with what was historically known as fundamentalism. Fundamentalism in the good sense. There are fundamentals of the Christian faith that are non-negotiable. There were more than four. How many? Five? I thought there were even more than five.
Well, the fundamentals, was it Carl Henry?
No, there was someone who even wrote earlier than Carl Henry.
There was the five fundamentals, and that's where the word fundamentals came from.
Right.
I can't remember who.
Well, that was within Presbyterianism.
Right. And fundamentalism actually became a little bit of an ecumenical movement because some of the best defenders of the Christian faith broadly might have been Presbyterian, but they went and lent their voices to other Christian communions for common cause. Well, I would say, to the other point, that the fundamentalist-modernist controversy is largely over. The denominations, the historic denominations, have collapsed into modernity. And evangelicalism came from fundamentalism, but it maintained a lower bar than fundamentalism. So we're no longer in the 1950s as we look at what we call evangelicalism. We're in the early 21st century. It's a new thing. It's a new situation. But and my first point earlier was, this is an American cultural phenomenon. It has its own history, its own evolution, and it's brought us to this place. So, yes, the protections didn't work, but I would rather have them than not. And we are no longer in the fundamentalist, modernist controversies. We are in a new situation. That would be my short answer. Something.
Mainline denominations would not be a part of the evangelical.
I would say there are evangelicals within the main lines, but they are dwindling. Even the Presbyterian Church USA is recognizing some of the hardcore Episcopalians and Presbyterians who were going to stay the course. Once they started ordaining homosexuals, Episcopal Church even making bishops, that broke the evangelicals. So they have formed new denominations.
I mean, they would consider themselves evangelicals.
Oh, they might. You know, this was Machen's point years ago, back in the 1930s, when he wrote Christianity and Liberalism. The scary thing about liberalism in the churches was nothing changed in terms of the practice of worship and the terminology that the churches used. What changed was what they meant. But, and this is the subtlety of the error. I still open the Bible on Sunday morning. We still have readings from Scripture. We still sing out of the hymn book. We still have communion. But all of these things have changed. They no longer signify what they once did in orthodox contexts. They now have new meanings. That Nathan Hatch, I should assign that book and ask for reading reports. Democratization of Christianity in America. He doesn't go so much into the modernist controversy, but you can see how it develops historically. Very important if you're an American Christian. If you're a Chinese Christian, probably not very important.